Man, I can't wait to see what my birthday activity is this year. You're the best robot pal a kid could ever... No. I think I might just answer this letter. Dear Tim and Moby, if forces are invisible, how do we know they exist? And how do they work? Thanks, Caitlin C. Forces are at work all the time, acting on everything around us. We can't see them, but some of their effects are pretty obvious. Like any time an object changes speed or direction. At its most basic, a force is a push or a pull, and it always involves two or more objects. Something providing the push or pull, like Moby, and the thing it affects, like, me. Well, it's never really that simple. Objects usually have lots of forces acting on them at the same time. Each one has a magnitude, the size of the force, and a direction. Put in fancy science terms, we say force is a vector quantity. Like, right now, we are pushing in opposite directions. But our forces are in balance, canceling each other out. That's why I'm not moving. The sum of the forces, or net force, is zero. 0 newtons, to be precise. That's the unit we use to measure force. It's named after Isaac Newton, the physicist who figured a lot of this stuff out. To get me in motion, you need to exert an unbalanced force on me. Ah! That's any push or pull where the net force is not zero. I am not getting in that thing. What? You're just trying to distract me, but fine. Right now, there are 3 main forces accounting for our movement. The engines are pulling the plane forward. There's friction, the resistance a surface puts on anything sliding over it. And drag, which is basically the friction of air molecules. Yeah, you would think the force of the engines must be greater than friction and drag. After all, we're moving forward. But notice how still it feels in here? If the forces were out of balance, we'd feel the push, and we'd be able to observe its effects. Well, we'd see a change in the plane's speed or direction. The combination of these 2 values is called velocity. We're not speeding up or slowing down, and we're heading in a straight line. So the net force on the plane is zero, same as if we weren't moving at all. We're going to need to accelerate if this hunk of junk is going to get off the ground. In physics, acceleration isn't just speeding up. It's any change in velocity, including speed-ups, slowdowns, and turns. There's a reason you can feel it when a car or a plane accelerates. It means there's an unbalanced force being applied to it and to you! Yep, the plane has to generate enough upward force to overcome gravity. It's a little different than the forces we've talked about so far. Friction, drag, you pushing me, those are all contact forces. They're between objects that are touching. Gravity is a non-contact force. It can affect objects that are separated, like the Earth and this plane. Magnetism and the electrical force are non-contact too. Like all non-contact forces, gravity acts through a field, an invisible area of influence. Fields get weaker the farther out you go from their source. But even way up here, Earth's gravitational field is still plenty strong, which is why I am absolutely not go. Oh, hi. Yep, the gravitational force is pulling us down, hard. It's opposed by drag, which is resisting our downward motion. The 2 forces are way unbalanced, that's why we're still accelerating. But the faster we go, the more drag increases. Eventually, those 2 forces will fall into balance. There we go. Our velocity is steady, which means we've stopped accelerating. So the net force on us is now zero. That's why it doesn't feel like we're falling anymore. More like floating. When we pull our cords, our parachutes will increase drag, so there will be a sudden, unbalanced force upward. Oof! But as we slow down, drag decreases. Eventually, drag and gravity balance again, and our velocity levels off. Hey, you know what? This was the best birthday present ever. Oh, you.
Welcome back. Welcome back. Welcome back. All right. We are jumping right into this new force and motion unit. Our target is to demonstrate and calculate how unbalanced forces change the speed or direction of an object's motion. So for today, we're going to view this video, What Are Forces? You should have a little strip in your notebook with your guided questions on that. You can print it and glue it in. You can write the questions down, or you can write incomplete sentences. Just writing random answers will not get you credit when it's time to grade your notebook. So let's get started. Forces. We're looking at how forces affect the motion of objects. Again, you should have the strip that looks like this one. It starts off with question number one, what is forces? And ends with question number 10 about creating a Venn diagram. So make sure you have the correct questions written down or copied and printed or whatever you did to get that information. We're going to go ahead and begin with a simple vocabulary word just because I'll use it a lot. I want to make sure you understand what it means. And that is magnitude. Magnitude is the amount of strength. So in this case, the amount of strength or the amount of force applied. When we're talking about forces, where you're going to hear that word magnitude quite a bit. So what is force? A force is any influence, such as a push or a pull, that causes an object to move or change its speed, direction, or shape. We're also going to say that forces cause acceleration. In science, acceleration is any change in motion. Okay, so it doesn't mean speeding up in science. It's any change in motion. So a force has a strength that is measured in newtons, and newtons are named after the famous scientist Isaac Newton. Forces have a direction, so that means that they are also going to be called vectors. Forces can be abbreviated with the direction the force is moving and then the amount of force applied. So you see the arrow above a number, like 12, for example. So what are balanced and unbalanced forces? Balanced forces are equal in size and opposite in direction. So the net force is going to be zero. If two objects push against each other in opposite directions with the same magnitude, nothing's going to move, so the forces are balanced. So there's not going to be a change in motion. You can also have balanced forces in an instance of constant motion, like cruise control, for example, in your car, or a plane. Once it reaches altitude, it doesn't change direction and it doesn't change its speed. That is also going to be balanced forces. So I don't want you to think that to be balanced, the object has to be stationary or still. The object can also be moving at a constant acceleration. That is also going to be balanced forces. So for unbalanced forces, the two forces are not equal in size and or they're not opposite in direction. So the net force doesn't equal zero. An unbalanced force is going to cause a change in motion. It's going to cause the object to slow down or to speed up. So the dog's pulling force is stronger than the force of friction. So the shoe is going to move backwards. It's going to be dragged toward the dog because the dog has overpowered the friction. So when we look at this, and we think we mentioned net force a little bit earlier, but net force is the sum of all forces acting on an object. Now, I know sum, you're going to think addition. Here, not necessarily. You may add, you may not. So you have to look at what's going on with the object. So the net force of an object is the combination of all forces acting on the object. This is going to determine if and how the object will accelerate. So if the forces are working in opposite directions and are not equal, then the force has, a magnitude equal to the difference in newtons between the two forces. Sounds like a lot. We're going to get deeper into that tomorrow. But if they are going it's going to move in the direction that is of the stronger force. So, for example, here you have the girl pedaling her bike. Well, the frictional force is 15, but the applied force is 20. So she's applying more force, so she's going to overpower that friction, which gives her a net force of 5 newtons. So 20 to the right, 15 to the left, is going to give her 5 newtons to the right. Now that is if we're going in opposite directions. So what are some types of contact forces? So friction is one type of contact force. It's caused by contact of surfaces. It's going to slow down or oppose motion. And it also turns motion into heat. Like when you rub your hands together, that's friction and you can feel the warmth. Rolling friction is when only a tiny bit of surface contacts is contacted. So like your tire, the entire tire doesn't touch the road at the same time. Static friction, your entire shoe is touching the ground. That keeps you standing. Fluid friction, that is going to occur inside of a gas or liquid, inside of a fluid. You can look at air resistance like that when you see parachutes, when you see jellyfish, as in the picture here. Sliding friction is continuous surface contact. Like poor little snails, they are constantly in contact with a surface. But they're using that friction to help propel them and help them move. Another type of contact force is buoyancy, and that is the upward force of fluid against an object. It's going to cause objects to float. So here you have gravity pushing down, but a buoyant force is going to push upward. Tension is a contact force. And it's a strain force due to pulling. So, for example, we got ropes or bridges, pulleys. All those are tension forces. Then we have non-contact forces. So gravity is a non-contact force. The objects do not have to touch to exert a force on each other. So gravity or gravitational force is an attraction force exerted between all matter in the universe. The magnitude is affected by two things, the mass of the objects and the distance between them. So the larger the mass, the more gravitational pull it has. So the smaller the mass, the less gravity. If things are farther apart, the impact of gravity is less than for things that are closer together. So the Earth experiences less of a pull from the Sun than Venus does, because Venus is closer. So some other types of non-contact forces are electrical forces, the interaction between positively and negatively charged matter, and then magnetic forces, the north and south poles of a magnetic material that create a magnetic force field. So all of those are non-contact forces. You know, you play with magnets. You know, you can chase the magnets around without touching them, without them touching each other. So this should have you at the bottom of your guided notes where you're creating the Venn diagram. That's going to pretty much serve as your reflection for this set of notes. You just comparing, contrasting characteristics of each balanced and unbalanced forces. If you've watched this far and done your notes, great. There is a brain pop at the end on Isaac Newton. I suggest you watch. Hopefully you watch this all the way so you can get some little benefits from watching that video that'll help you on the assignment on Friday. So you can take more notes on that. But if you watch the screen, you'll see where and what you should focus on. Just know that you can use these notes on any assignment we do during the 9 weeks.
Can you please stop telling Houston that we have a problem?
Dear Tim and Moby, who was Isaac Newton? Sincerely, Dylan. Sir Isaac Newton was an English physicist, mathematician, astronomer, and natural philosopher. Well, you don't get a reputation as one of the most influential figures in the history of science by being good in just one subject. Newton was born in 1643 in the town of Woolsthorpe by Colsterworth. That's where he would do some of his most famous work, including helping invent calculus and coming up with his theory of universal gravitation. But before that, he almost became a farmer. At age 17, Newton was away studying at school when his mother ordered him back home to learn the farming trade. Luckily, the school's headmaster convinced his mother to send Newton back. After finishing with high marks, he enrolled at Trinity College at the University of Cambridge, where he studied for the next 4 years. The school shut down in 1665 because of an outbreak of plague, so after getting his degree, Newton went home to continue his scientific explorations. Yeah, that's where he saw the famous apple. According to legend, Newton was sitting by his window in Woolsthorpe Manor when he saw an apple falling from one of the trees in his garden. That got him thinking about the mysterious force that pulled the apple to the ground, and whether it was the same force that kept the moon in orbit around the Earth, and the Earth around the Sun. Newton decided that it was, and this force, which he called gravity, affects every object in the universe, depending on its mass and distance. Hey, watch where you're going. So, in 1687, Newton published this universal law of gravitation. It was in a book called the Philosophiae Naturalis Principia Mathematica, usually just shortened to the Principia. Newton also used the Principia to unveil his other major contribution to physics, his three laws of motion, which explain how and why stuff moves. You can find out more about them in our Newton's Laws of Motion movie. But physics was just one part of Newton's work. He was also pretty good with numbers. He's one of the inventors of calculus, the kind of math that lets us measure curves and irregular shapes. And then there's Newton's work in optics, the branch of physics that deals with the properties of light. By refracting light through a prism, he discovered that white light is made up of a whole spectrum of colors. Using this discovery, he invented a new kind of telescope, the reflecting telescope. Back then, refracting telescopes formed images by using lenses to bend light, resulting in a lot of the colors being lost. Newton's reflecting telescope avoided this problem by using mirrors to reflect light, resulting in a much higher quality image. Yeah, he was eventually knighted, but it wasn't for his contributions to science. Newton received his knighthood as a reward for his work as the master of the Royal Mint in London. He used his position at the Mint to completely reform English currency, and he devoted a lot of time and energy to punishing counterfeiters, too. Of course, he'll always be known for his scientific work. In 1703, Newton was named President of the Royal Society, the most prestigious organization of scientists in England. And when he died in 1727, he became the first scientist to be buried in Westminster Abbey, the famous church where English monarchs are buried. But his long list of discoveries, theories, and laws lives on, becoming the driving force behind the scientific revolution and inspiring future thinkers. Once people realized that the inner workings of nature could be revealed through rational and universally accepted scientific methods, all sorts of doors were opened. No, not that door.